From Pacifica, this is Democracy Now! As President Trump attempts to temporarily ban refugees from six Muslim-majority nations, we'll look at how one of Washington's closest allies has instituted a travel ban of its own. Israel plans to bar entry to supporters of the Boycott, Divestment, and Sanctions movement, known as BDS. We'll get response from the head of Jewish Voice for Peace and award-winning Israeli-American filmmaker Uri Aloni, and discuss Aloni's new film, Junction 48, about an aspiring Palestinian rap artist who uses his hip-hop to fight back against the Israeli state's policies.
You're an Arabic Israeli rapper?
I'd say so.
We welcome Kareem Awad. Shut up, he's a real star.
My songs are not political. I just describe the place I live.
We'll also speak with the lead actor and musical director of Junction 48, Tamer Naffar, a Palestinian citizen of Israel and founder of the Palestinian hip-hop group Dom. Then we look at the latest trove of documents published by WikiLeaks this week.
On Tuesday, the 7th of March, WikiLeaks began its new series of leaks on the Central Intelligence Agency, codenamed Vault 7. This series of publications is the largest ever publication of confidential documents on the agency.
Thousands of leaked documents published by WikiLeaks describe CIA programs to hack into both Apple and Android cell phones, smart TVs, and even cars. We'll speak with Cindy Cohen, executive director of the Electronic Frontier Foundation. All that and more coming up. To Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman. South Korea's Constitutional Court removed President Park Geun-hye from office Friday over charges of graft and corruption. The unanimous ruling strips Park of immunity from prosecution, clearing the way for her to face criminal charges. Park's power had been sharply reduced since December, when South Korea's parliament voted overwhelmingly to impeach her. Outside the courthouse in the capital, Seoul, Friday, thousands of Park supporters tried to break through police barricades. At least two people were killed in the violence. South Korea's prime minister and acting president, Hwang Kyo-ahn, appealed for calm.
In order to stop internal conflicts from intensifying, we should manage the social order and keep a stable government so that national anxiety and the international society's concern can be settled.
A new election will be held in 60 days. Park's Conservative Party appears headed to defeat, and its fall from power could mean South Korea's next leader will take a more conciliatory approach to North Korea. The upheaval comes days after North Korea test-fired several ballistic missiles and as the Trump administration began deploying a missile defense system to South Korea. Chinese officials warn the U.S. is escalating a regional arms race. In Washington, D.C., House lawmakers advanced legislation Thursday to repeal and replace the Affordable Care Act. The Energy and Commerce Committee cleared the measure on a 31-23 vote along party lines, capping a hearing that lasted over 27 hours. It followed a similar marathon session in the Ways and Means Committee, which also voted along party lines. This is Texas Republican Committee Chair Kevin Brady.
This is Obamacare gone. This is the first and most important step to giving relief to Americans from this terrible law and to begin the replacement principles of restoring state control and restoring the free market that conservatives, moderates, all Republicans have built consensus around.
House Republicans are moving rapidly to pass their health care legislation, with committee markups coming less than 2 days after the bill was made public. Democrats objected to the pace of the Republican push, noting it took months of debate to craft the Affordable Care Act of 2009. They say the GOP is ramming through the legislation ahead of a Congressional Budget Office report expected Monday that will assess the cost and impact of the bill. This is Georgia Democratic Congressmember John Lewis.
Mr. Chairman, the bill we have been considering today is fundamentally flawed. Tax cut for the rich, wealthy, and cooperation are the priority. The sick, the elderly, the middle class, and working American are left out and left behind.
The legislation would end the Affordable Care Act's expansion of Medicaid by 2020. Under pressure from conservative Republicans, the White House on Thursday pressed lawmakers to sunset Medicaid expansion even sooner. The move could put medical treatment, nursing care and other benefits out of reach for millions of poor and disabled Americans. Meanwhile, several Republican senators questioned whether the House bill has support to pass the Senate. Arkansas Senator Tom Cotton, a Republican, tweeted, quote, "House health care bill can't pass Senate without major changes. To my friends in House, pause, start over, get it right, don't get it fast," he tweeted. In climate news, the newly confirmed head of the Environmental Protection Agency, Scott Pruitt, said Thursday carbon dioxide emissions are not a major contributor to global warming. Pruitt made the comment during an interview with CNBC host Joe Kernan.
Do you believe that it's been proven that CO2 is the primary control knob for climate? Do you believe that?
No, I think that measuring with precision human activity on the climate is something very challenging to do, and there's tremendous disagreement about the degree of impact. So no, I would not agree that it's a primary contributor to the global warming that we see.
Okay.
All right. But we don't know that yet. As far as we need to continue the debate and continue the review and the analysis.
Scott Pruitt's comment defies scientific consensus about the laws of physics and could put him at odds with U.S. law. Federal courts have ruled the EPA is obligated to regulate carbon dioxide under the Clean Air Act. The EPA's own website even features a fact sheet declaring, quote, "greenhouse gases act like a blanket around the Earth, trapping energy in the atmosphere and causing it to warm," unquote. Meanwhile, a top official at the EPA has resigned in protest of a Trump administration proposal to entirely defund his office. Mustafa Ali helped found the EPA's Office of Environmental Justice in 1992 and served under both Republican and Democratic administrations. Ali told Inside Climate News, quote, "My values and priorities seem to be different than our current leadership, and because of that, I feel that it's best if I take my talents elsewhere," unquote. In more climate news, the Trump administration asked a federal judge this week to halt a landmark trial brought by 21 young people who say the federal government is denying their constitutional rights by promoting fossil fuel extraction and greenhouse gas emissions. On Capitol Hill, the Senate Foreign Relations Committee voted 12-9 Thursday to advance the nomination of David Friedman for U.S. ambassador to Israel. Friedman has no diplomatic experience. He worked as a bankruptcy lawyer for Donald Trump over the last 15 years. He's a longtime supporter of illegal Jewish settlements in the occupied West Bank, who's called President Barack Obama an anti-Semite. He's also compared liberal American Jews to Nazi collaborators. New Jersey Democrat Robert Menendez joined every committee Republican in support of Friedman, sending his confirmation to a vote by the full Senate. The top commander of U.S. forces deployed in war zones told Congress Thursday he wants to send more troops to Afghanistan to break a stalemate with the Taliban. General Joseph Votel, head of the U.S. Central Command, was speaking to the Senate Armed Services Committee.
I do believe it will involve additional forces to ensure that we can make the advise and assist mission more effective.
The U.S. currently has 8,400 troops deployed in Afghanistan, alongside roughly three times as many contractors. General Votel said he believes a few thousand more troops were needed, but did not commit to an exact number. The testimony came as the Pentagon began deploying 400 additional Marines to Syria. Former National Security Advisor Michael Flynn worked as a foreign agent for the Turkish government last fall, even as he served as a top advisor to Donald Trump's campaign, and failed to disclose his lobbying efforts as required by law. The revelation came in a retroactive filing by Flynn himself with the Justice Department on Tuesday. It reveals he was paid more than $500,000 to lobby on behalf of a firm linked to the Turkish government. By failing to register with the federal government, Flynn violated the Foreign Agent Registration Act. On Election Day, Flynn authored an op-ed piece in the newspaper The Hill calling for the extradition to Turkey of a prominent opponent of President Erdogan, who's lived in Pennsylvania since 1999. At the White House, Press Secretary Sean Spicer was asked if Donald Trump knew of Flynn's work as a foreign agent.
I don't believe that that was known. I would refer you to General Flynn and to the Department of Justice in terms of the filings that have been made.
Had the president have known that, would he have appointed him?
I don't know, John. That's a hypothetical that I'm not prepared to ask. I don't know what he discussed prior to prior to being appointed in terms of his background, his resume, his client base. I don't know any of that.
That last month, the White House fired Michael Flynn as National Security Advisor. Following revelations, he discussed U.S. sanctions against Russia with the Russian ambassador before Donald Trump's inauguration and did not reveal this fact to Vice President Pence. FBI Director James Comey met top senators on Capitol Hill Thursday amidst mounting calls for an investigation into ties between the Trump administration and Russia. Comey held separate meetings with Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, Minority Leader Chuck Schumer, and senior members of the Senate Intelligence Committee. It's not clear what was discussed, but the talks followed President Trump's unsubstantiated claims last weekend that President Obama wiretapped Trump Tower. WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange said Thursday he will help high-tech companies protect consumers against CIA spying. The offer came 2 days after WikiLeaks published thousands of documents describing CIA programs to hack into both Apple and Android cell phones, smart TVs, and even cars and trucks. Assange spoke in an online news conference from the Ecuadorian embassy in London.
The Central Intelligence Agency lost control of its entire cyber weapons arsenal. Now, this is a historic act of devastating incompetence to have created such an arsenal and stored it all in one place and not secured it.
After headlines, we'll speak with Cindy Cohen of the Electronic Frontier Foundation about the largest leak of classified material in CIA history. In Washington, D.C., the owners of a local restaurant filed suit Thursday against President Donald Trump, alleging they're losing business due to unfair competition from the Trump International Hotel. The owners of Cork Wine Bar say they've lost patrons who seek to curry favor with the president. This is Stephen Schooner, lawyer for the plaintiffs.
Today, whether you are a foreign government, a lobbyist, or a special interest group, there is no easier way to funnel money directly to the President of the United States with no transparency whatsoever than by spending money in the President's hotel or his restaurants or through an event hosted in that facility.
At the White House, Press Secretary Sean Spicer was asked about the lawsuit.
The president has made very clear in that December press conference at Trump Tower he doesn't have conflicts, and he's done everything in accordance with the guidance that he's given and gone well beyond what he ever needed to do.
As president, Trump has rejected advice from ethics experts to divest his vast business holdings or create a completely blind trust, and instead handed over management of the Trump Organization to his sons. The head of the Office of Government Ethics slammed that decision as wholly inadequate. A former contributor to Fox News has reportedly settled the lawsuit charging she was sexually assaulted by an executive at the network. Tamara Holder says Fox News Latino vice president Francisco Cortez tried to force her to perform oral sex when the two were alone in his office in February of 2015. The New York Times reports Holder won a settlement of more than $2.5 million. The settlement follows the resignation of Fox News chair Roger Ailes last July, who stepped down amidst multiple accusations that he sexually harassed women at the network. Mother Jones reporter Shane Bauer will share this year's Izzy Award with Seth Fried Wessler of the Nation Institute after the two worked independently to reveal major abuses at for-profit U.S. prisons. The annual Izzy Award is presented by the Park Center for Independent Media and named for the legendary dissident journalist I.F. Stone. Other winners include Nation writer Ari Berman, who exposed Republican efforts to suppress the vote. Collecting a special documentary honor prize is America Divided, a documentary series covering inequality in education, housing, healthcare, criminal justice, and the political system. To see interviews with all of this year's Izzy Award winners, go to democracynow.org. And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman.
And I'm Nermeen Sheikh. Welcome to our listeners and viewers around the country and around the world. We begin today's show with an update on the case of prominent immigrant rights advocate Ravi Ragbir, who we interviewed Thursday on Democracy Now! Right before his check-in with a deportation officer. Ragbir, originally from Trinidad, immigrated to the U.S. legally but has a 15-year-old criminal conviction. He's avoided deportation since 2011 due to a series of stays that could end under Trump.
After Ravi left our studios, he spoke at a news conference and rally yesterday, where hundreds gathered to support him before he went inside, unsure if he would come back out. As Ravi Ragbir spoke, he was flanked by his wife, his attorney, pastors, and at least four elected officials, the New York City Council Speaker, two New York City Council members, as well as a New York State Senator who would also accompany him inside.
When I look out here, when I look out at you, each and everyone here who has come out for me, I'm overwhelmed. And what this is, this is a sea of love. Yes. This is like the Katrina that is going to overtake any wall that is going to be built, because this sea that is love is going to make that change.
We are ready. We are ready.
There will be a delegation now accompanying Mr. Ragbir into 26 Federal Plaza.
Prayers. Thank you. Thank you.
Goes to his check-in, we are going to be circling the building. We are going to be walking around and praying.
Can you explain the Jericho Walk? We see them coming, in fact, right now. This is around Foley Square and the federal building.
So the Jericho Walk is an interfaith act of solidarity. It's supposed to be seven times around the building. They start with a prayer, and they ask, you know, for immigrant justice, justice for all workers, immigrant and non-immigrant. And it's a prayer tearing down the walls. So that's both, like, border walls, but, you know, the walls of 26 Federal Plaza, where people have to check in and face deportation every day.
So Ravi's out. He's out. He's okay.
Ravi Ragbir, who is the immigrant rights activist who went into his check-in not knowing whether he would be detained or released, is coming out in just a few minutes. Renee Feltz, maybe you can explain what's just taken place.
Well, Amy, like many immigrants facing deportation, Ravi went in with a support group that included people who had set up a text alert system. And we all just received a very good text alert. It says, Ravi checked in and everything is okay with him for now. Thanks for all the support. And we believe he's about to come out any minute now.
Alina Das, I am very proud to be Ravi's friend, colleague, and his lawyer. And I'm here to report, as you can see, that we are very grateful and humble that Ravi is here with us. He was able to check out of that appointment and to be returned to his family. We know from what we saw from loved ones that we talked to there that not everyone is that lucky. And that there are people there right now who are facing re-detention and deportation. However, we are saddened by the news that we received in the check-in appointment, where they asked Ravi to come back in 1 month to check in again and to make efforts to get a travel document. We don't know what this means. Ravi does have a stay of removal that is in place and remains in place until 2018.
How do I feel about coming out? You would think that I will be happy coming back out. And I am happy to be back here with my family, to sit with you, to sing with you, to talk to you. Yes, I am. But I have to go through this again.
It's
gonna
be all right.
We love you, Ravi.
We're gonna be all right.
We'll be there.
Thank you.
How do I, how do I have this knife, this guillotine over my neck and be able to function? Have my wife and my friends, knowing that they asked me for a travel document, they asked me for a passport. You know, when they ask for that, it usually means one thing, right? They say, no, we're not going to use anything, everything stays the same. But if everything stays the same, I shouldn't be checking in next month. And I hate to be the bearer of bad news, but I'm a realist. I need to know what could happen, and I have to prepare for what could happen. And I hope I'm wrong. You know, we were expecting on November 9th, when we saw November 8th, when we saw the election results, we knew what was going to happen. We knew that today was going to be a hard day, and we were prepared for that. But we were wrong, and I'm glad to be wrong. Glad to be wrong in this time. And I hope I'm wrong on April 11th. But no matter what, we are going to be ready. I am going to be ready, and I'm not going to just sit back quietly and just let them take me away. I'm going to stand up. I'm going to fight. I'm going to speak about this. I am going to invite you all to join me. It's not right for anyone. And you have to remember, I have support. I have you guys. I've met you guys. I've been with you guys. And you all are here for me. But imagine those who do not. I am the focus right now, but the focus should be on everyone. So what are we going to do?
Who are we?
Rally!
Who are we?
Rally!
Will we be divided?
No!
Will we Immigrant be divided? Rights advocate Ravi Ragbir speaking upon his release on Thursday after he checked in with his deportation officer. Although his stay of deportation lasts another year, they've told him to come back with travel documents in 1 month, April 11th. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org. Special thanks to Andre Lewis and Renee Feltz. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh. Back in a minute. اكتب لك اغنية حب ملامك لشهاب ببدع في كل اشي واشي وببلم بالاشهاب بدك خيا بوصب المطر بطن كرجف بس بكره المطر تراوما سقف بتلف بحط طناجر كل القرن المي في كل الغرف وصلت لي فل الركب بدي صد النقط بحط اغنية الحب بالجرور بتعود تعود بعد ما فوق كل الوقت فاق صفيت مبلولة عتقتك تطلعيني من الشارع دخلك غطيني في ملابسك خايف فبين مليان وضعيف انا جنبي اطردي مني جن الفقير اطردي مني جن القاهر اطردي مني شعور ما فيش بكره اطردي مني جن السم اطردي مني دين البنك اعطوني لكن ما فيش بكره يا ريت يا ريت يا ريت اكتب لك قديش حبيتك بلا شطار لاني عم بشكي من حيط وببني حيط بيني وبينك يا ريت يا ريت يا ريت اكتب لك قديش حبيتك يا ريت محمود درويش كتب بنسير شعب لما الشاعر يكتب وصف إباحي لبطن راقصة الله يرحمكم بزودها بنسير شعب لما بطن الراقص وصف إباحي عيدين شاعرة فبكتب That's the theme song from the new film Junction 48, performed by Tamer Naffar and Samar Kupti. We'll be joined by Tamar in just a minute. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, The War and Peace Report. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.
While President Trump has made international headlines for his attempt to temporarily ban refugees and residents of some Muslim-majority nations, one of Washington's closest allies has instituted a travel ban of its own. Earlier this week, Israeli lawmakers approved a law barring supporters of the Boycott, Divestment and Sanctions Movement, known as BDS, from entering Israel. The BDS movement is an international campaign to pressure Israel to comply with international law and respect Palestinian rights. The Israeli parliament voted to ban non-Israelis from entering the country if they, or any organizations they are part of, support the boycott. After the law was passed, the Israeli parliament, or Knesset, posted a message on its site reading, quote, "In recent years, calls to boycott Israel have been growing. It seems this is a new front in the war against Israel, which until now the country had not prepared for properly."
The ban has been widely criticized, even by critics of BDS. The American Jewish Committee, which opposes the boycott movement, said the law will not defeat BDS, nor, quote, nor will it help Israel's image as the beacon of democracy in the Middle East it is, unquote. The publication Inside Higher Public Ed reports a group of Jewish studies scholars are preparing to release an open letter opposing the law, describing it as a, quote, further blow to the democratic foundations of Israel, unquote. Professor Mara Benjamin of St. Olaf College, who opposes BDS, said the ban, quote, will have a chilling effect on scholarship, as well as on all people who care about having a healthy democracy in the state of Israel, unquote. Well, today we begin our discussion with three guests. Rebecca Wilcomerson is Executive Director of Jewish Voice for Peace here in New York. Also with us are two guests who are involved with a new film that's just premiered in New York. It's called Junction 48. The Israeli filmmaker Uri Aloni is with us. He directed the film. And the Palestinian actor Tamer Nafar is the film's star and musical director. We welcome you all to Democracy Now! At first, we were just going to be talking about the film. But given the fact that while Tamer and Uri came to the United States, this ban was passed, we thought we'd start by asking you, what is your response? Uri, you're an Israeli-American. Your mother, a very famous First Lady of Human Rights, Shulamit Aloni, was a longtime member of the Israeli parliament, the Knesset. Your thoughts on this ban?
First, the ban is much worse than even you described it, because it's a ban even if somebody boycotted only the settlement. So if somebody here in America is against war crime and against stealing lands from Palestinians by Jews, he's already not allowed into America. So people who support it, for me, they really—
Into America or Israel?
Into Israel, sorry. And it's very important to mention it, because already you hear Government Cuomo is helping those anti-democratic thing, because he passed a bill here that people who support the BDS are not allowed to receive money from the states of New York. So really, when Cuomo look at the mirror, he should see Trump, because I feel that people who doesn't let us to live in democracy, they are the true anti-Semitic, because they believe that we, Israeli Jews, don't have the right to change our system. And this is horrific. In one hand, in a way, I'm happy that now we reveal something about the true Israel, because, you know, now it's Purim, when all the Jews putting masks. And once we used to have a liberal mask. The most famous mask now in Israel is the mask of a soldier who murdered cold blood a wounded prisoner of war. Those are the masks that most of the Israeli kids now are using. So now when the mask and the truth is the same, maybe it's time for Democrats here to stop support Israel if they care about Jews.
And Rebecca, can you talk about what the impact of this ban is likely to be on some in the American Jewish community who are also opposed, support BDS and are opposed to settlements?
Yeah, I mean, I can start with how it's going to affect me personally. I'm a proud supporter of the BDS movement. My organization, Jewish Voice for Peace, supports BDS. I also happen to have really strong ties to Israel. My grandparents are buried there. My aunt, my uncle, my cousins live there. I'm married to an Israeli. My kids are Israeli. I've lived myself 3 years in Israel. I have a lot of friends and family, you know, Jews, Palestinians on both sides of the Green Line. And it seems like, this bill is basically saying that I'm not welcome to come back. And so for myself personally, it's a really sad moment. I do want to emphasize that the real impact of the bill is going to be on Palestinians. So, of course, Palestinians in the diaspora who are willing to speak up for their rights, they're not going to be able to come in. And also Palestinians in the West Bank, Gaza, and even East Jerusalem. So in terms of if they're married to Palestinians inside of Israel but don't have permanent residency, they may not be able to reunite with their families. Or if they leave the country, they may not be able to come back. If they want to get medical care inside of Israel, they may not be able to enter just because they're speaking up for their rights. So like Uri was saying, I think this is a real shift. It makes overt a policy that was already to a certain extent in place, but a little bit underwater. Because what happened is people would try to come into Israel, and based on racial profiling, people would be rejected at the border, usually Palestinians, Arabs, Muslims, people who looked Muslim even, other people of color. So they'd be taken aside and often deported. But now it's this categorical ban that's very overt. And like Uri said, it takes the mask off and shows how anti-democratic Israel's becoming.
Is it the first time Jews will not be able to? Some will be stopped from going to Israel. Palestinians know well not having the right of return.
Right.
But for Jews, this will be—is this a first?
Yes. I mean, there's been one or two instances. There was a famous— Yeah, exactly. Noam Chomsky was the first and famous incident where he was rejected at the border. But in terms of saying, like, Jews who have certain political—who have certain political standards, you're not welcome here, this is absolutely a first.
I wanted to go to Tamer Nafar, who is joining us. He was just in New York for the premiere of Junction 48. He's the musical director and the star of the film, hip-hop artist well-known for his group, the hip-hop group Dom. Now, you, Tamer, are Palestinian, but you are also an Israeli citizen. You live in, well, the city that is featured in Junction 48, Lid, which is right near Tel Aviv Airport. How will this affect you? I think we have a very long delay in linking up with him in Champaign-Urbana in Illinois.
This ban thing? I think that, you know, Palestinians have been banned since forever, and nobody—and it's an inhuman act, and it's a—for me, it's a crime issue. So nobody has punished Israel ever since they were banning Palestinians. And so Israel now feels the power that they can just move on with it, and now they are trying to ban other people that they are not Palestinians. And I think if it's not being—if we still don't put Israel to itself—to that spot and put it on their place, then it's going to get bigger and bigger, because that's the whole thing with Israel. When they do things and nobody's punishing them, not even criticizing them, then that will get them the rank of power to continue on growing up and doing whatever they do.
Udi, could you comment on the fact that many have drawn comparisons between Trump's most recent, and although it's the second version of it, executive order, which bans refugees and Muslims and people from six Muslim-majority countries from coming into the U.S., the comparison between that ban and what Israel has just instituted?
I want to say it's maybe worse, because the real law that Israel passed just a few weeks ago said that legally Jews allowed to steal lands from Palestinians only because they are Jews and those are Palestinian. I want to repeat it, because people here in America don't believe it. We have a new law that settlers allowed to steal private lands of Arabs and take it to Jews. This is an official law. And now they're going to ban everyone who criticizes a pure apartheid law. So in a way, it's horrific. It's only everyone who stands for civil rights in the minimum level, liberals, not radical, is not allowed to Israel. I think that Trump and Bibi are in competition who is getting worse or who is getting more weird about anti-democratic laws. And they're very similar, and they enjoy each other too much.
Rebecca. Yeah, I mean, I would completely agree that, you know, both bans are completely xenophobic, however they define the other. They're based on this sort of security culture, this sense of fear, and really cruel laws that are, you know, excluding refugees, including people who have rights to enter these lands. And so I think that this mirroring is really problematic. And I think, but the thing that I also want to come back to is that it is a sign that I think that we're winning globally. And the fear that Israel has of BDS and the fact that they felt the need to legislate against this law, it's not going to work. People are not going to stay silent about this just because Israel's trying to make this ban. It seems like it's part of the natural evolution of a struggle like this, that as the movement grows, they're going to try to shut it down. And this is the next step.
I wanted to ask Tamer Nafar about Israel just introducing another bill. This was on Wednesday, to limit Muslim calls to prayer. The bill has won preliminary approval, though critics have denounced the measure as racist. Supporters of the bill say it's aimed at improving the quality of life of people living near mosques who have been losing sleep. Opponents say the legislation, which was sponsored by right-wing parties, impinges on the religious freedom of Israel's Muslim minority. This is Israeli-Arab lawmaker Ahmad Tibi.
This law is racist. This is its fate, to be torn apart. Islam and the call to prayer are stronger than all of you.
The proponents of the bill call the Muslim call to prayer noise pollution. Tamer Nafar, your response.
As I said, this is things that this place is heading to. So I wouldn't be surprised or shocked if 10 years from now or 20 years from now, Muslims or Christians or non-Jews will be scared to reveal their religion, and they will be walking without hiding their religion. And that's where the place is heading to. But again, these things are being revealed now. But I've heard, but I live in a place where before that you have mosque demolitions, you have Islamic places where they're being demolished. So it's always happening, but this time it's happening louder. The volume is up and the cameras are on, but it's always happening. And I think that now with the Trump era, I think it's easy. It's like a stage. It's easier for them to do it. Like it's legit now. But these things have been happening since forever.
Well, we continue our conversation about Israel by looking at the film that's just been released, titled Junction 48. The film centers on Karim, an aspiring Palestinian rap artist who lives in an impoverished, mixed Palestinian-Jewish city near Tel Aviv called Lid. Junction 48 shows how Karim and his Palestinian girlfriend Manar and their friends use hip-hop to fight back against Israel's policies. The role of Karim is played by Tamer Nafar, a rap artist with the Palestinian hip-hop group Dam. This is the film's trailer.
I understand that the fridge was new. That is why it was repossessed.
Wow, that's really cool.
Honest.
Incredible.
You're an Arabic-Israeli rapper?
I'd say so.
We welcome Karim Awad. Shut up, he's a real star.
My songs are not political. I just describe the place I live.
They're tearing down Talal's house.
We have the right to demonstrate.
Let's make music.
We are a traditional family. Manar's performance will bring us shame. And if that happens, we'll be forced to use other means with her.
We have 500,000 downloads and haven't even started. Can you imagine how this might end?
Israelis, cousins, families, enemies everywhere.
That's not funny.
Shut up.
Don't make us angry.
We have to stick together.
There is always this thing pulling me down.
That's the trailer for Junction 48. To talk more about the film, we are joined by the film's director, Udi Aloni, Israeli-American film director, and the lead actor and musical director, Tamer Nafar. Udi is an award-winning filmmaker. The director and producer of Junction 48, his previous films include Local Angel, Forgiveness, and Art Violence, the author of What Does a Jew Want? On Binationalism and Other Specters. Tamer Nafar is the lead actor in Junction 48, the music director of the film, also co-authored the screenplay. He is a rap artist with the Palestinian hip-hop group Dam. Tamer is a Palestinian citizen of Israel who lives in Lid, as Israelis call it Lod, this community that the film is based in, just near Tel Aviv airport. Udi, talk about this film. You haven't gotten enormously positive reviews from the New York Times in the past. They've now written five pieces since this won, what, the Audience Award here at Tribeca Film Festival.
The first award.
The first award.
The Audience Award was in Berlin.
Oh, we're
doing
Audience
well.
Award. And you just got the New York Times did it as a critic's pick. But this is a fascinating film that also, I think, for the first time in a feature film, includes a housing demolition.
Tamer and me are very close friends for 15 years. We are doing a lot of stuff together. And I think really we're following Edward Said's call to create a binational language. And not only we create art together, we're standing on many house demolition against the bulldozers together. And we all the time try to work between art, theory, and action. We always with our body in the place. But the movie really has to be that, for me, when I think about house demolition, The quality has to be perfect because we are not only demolish house of Palestinian, it's a culture demolition. Israel put so much energy to destroy the Palestinian as a culture that the minute Tamer referred to himself as Palestinian, not as an Israeli Arab, the Minister of Culture tried to destroy every show of Tamer around the country. And she stepped out when he performed in our Oscar winning. So the house demolition for us has to be also the relation of from 48. It's an ongoing demolition. It's an ongoing Nakba. It's an ongoing disaster from the Palestinians. And shooting it was, for me, very important, the details, the way I experience it. And Tamer and me work really, like, even the way the people speak, the way they react, the way that the day after they can go all on the demolition and do a song, a protest song. People here in America don't destroy it, how they can sing after the house was demolished, how they can smile. But it's an ongoing fight. You cannot, like, let the Israeli destroy their spirit. So the house demolition, it's also the performance after of Tamer on it, in front of audience, said, we will rebuild this house again. In the Negev, there is a village that the Bedouin Palestinian built already, I think, 70 times. Again and again, after Israel demolished their house. Just for you to know, in Israel, they demolish a Bedouin village now, Umr Hiran, just in order to bring Jews' village on it. Not for any other reason. They really replace Jews with Arabs on a place that Arabs live for 50 years already.
So, well, let's go to a clip from the film Junction 48. In this scene, Karim is being interviewed on an Israeli news program.
And now we have Karim Avid.
Awad.
Sorry, it's Awad.
Awad.
The first Israeli Arab rapper.
What a celebrity.
My songs are not political. They just describe the place I come from.
Looks like he's been doing this all his life.
You come from Lod, which ironically is a city most Israelis don't know. Why do you think that is?
Lod is a tough place, especially on our side. I'm talking about poverty, neglected schools. I'm talking about settlers, police brutality towards us, police corruption. We live 15 kilometers from... Sorry, I can say... Right?
Funny guy.
I'm not trying to be funny. I'm trying to explain that you don't know we exist.
You said you're not political.
I'm not political, but does it make sense to you that to build a museum of coexistence, they have to demolish my friend's home?
I swear, he's the man.
He shouldn't have mentioned the house. It will open the door for evil.
Well, let's go to another clip from the film Junction 48.
And they want me to get married. That way, I'll be someone else's responsibility, not theirs. What do you think?
Sorry, eh?
Honestly?
I'm being serious now.
I'm glad I don't have a sister.
You don't want a problem like me?
Manar, we talked about this. I have no income, no job, nothing. If I make it big, we can live off the music. Okay? Do you want to come and sing with us tonight at the Marley?
In Hebrew?
In Hebrew, yes.
Go perform for the Jews by yourself.
My love, I didn't mean it. I was just kidding. Come back.
Karim, my cousins are here.
What are you talking about? So, Jews, cousins, family, same.
Not funny. Huh? Now, for real, Karim, I can't have my cousins following me around.
So those are clips from the film Junction 48. So, Udi Aloni, you directed this film. Can you talk about what the character Karim says in the first clip about his songs, responding to a question about whether his work is political? And then this last scene between Karim and his girlfriend, Nafar.
Yeah, I really want to tell you, it's good that you
put... Manar is the name of his girlfriend.
It's very important. The film is fun. We want to be all to create high art. And this is when Tamer said, I'm not political. It's kind of the wish of the oppressed to be non-political. But really, the only person who can be non-political is only the privileged. Only the privileged can say, I'm doing pure art. So when Tamer said, I'm not political, and we have a great song, Anamish Politi, that it really mean, even if I come with a bag on a bus, I become a political entity because everyone looked at me. And...
I wanted to ask Tamer to also respond to this. Tamer Nafar, who is with us, Tamer Nafar, who is with us from afar, who is with us, it seems, much farther than he is because of this long delay when we ask him a question. But he's in the studios of WILL in Champaign-Urbana. When that question was put to you, you're playing Karim, but it is semi-autobiographical. You co-wrote the screenplay. And you said, my songs are not political. They just describe the place I come from. Can you talk about what that means to you, Tamer?
First off, the screenplay was also from it was a cooperation with me and Ori Moverman, the amazing Ori Moverman. And this specific interview in the movie. When he says, I'm not political, it becomes a song, like Udi said, Anamish Politi, which you can get it now from iTunes, from the soundtrack of Junction 48. The whole music was by me and by Itamar Ziegler. And when he say, I'm not political, I think he really means it, that he's not political. They are demolishing his friend's house, and he's going to stand up for his friend. For him, it's not political. But the reasons for demolishing the house are political. But for him, it's not political. Or maybe that's the turn-up point where he needs to understand, where he starts to understand that he has some responsibility because the place he's living in. And you cannot not be political because it's not a privileged thing, that, like Udi said. So being a Palestinian living inside of Israel, I cannot see you not being political. To tell somebody not to be political, that's like, tell women not to be feminist after the awful quotations that Trump said. So
I also wanted to ask you. I wanted to ask you, Tamer, about the house that you all built for the film that you would then demolish, and the coincidence of once you built it, you got a message from Tel Aviv, from the Israeli government, that this house would have to be demolished. Is that right? And what was that like in your community of Lid, what it meant to demolish this house?
Udi decided to build the whole house with the furniture in it, just so you can feel it, just so you can feel the cinema of it, just so you can even feel the dust in your eyes when you when the house is demolished, just so you can feel what these people, what we go through. I mean, I live in Lid. Lid is an Israeli city according to the officiality of the city itself, and it's and it has more than around 30,000 Palestinians, Arab, who pay taxes, who vote, like this whole democracy thing. And we still get our house demolished. And we're talking about more than 300 houses being demolished. And while we talk now, we have almost 5,000-6,000 houses with warrants demolitions that can happen in every minute when the Israeli government decides. So for my people in Lid to watch this house demolition, that was very tearful and that was very hard to see it coming to see it finally getting documented. Because normally in Israeli movies about Palestinians, they don't show you the physical occupation. They don't show you the house demolition. You normally, if you want to see something bad, it's always the Arabic who's bad, who's extremely explosion, who's extreme. You can show the physical of it, but if they want to be like liberal, they will talk about the occupation, but they will not show how ugly it is. And I'm very proud that we did that. I'm very proud that that Udi directed it in this way, and actually you can see, and I remember that was one of the hardest scenes for us on the set. Even the Jews on the set, who are not politically 100% with me or Udi, it was hard for them to see that, and it was good for me, satisfying for me to look and to show them this is what is happening every day. So that's one of the most scenes that really influences me in the movie.
We just have 30 seconds, Udi, but this film is not only opening in New York. I mean, you're going to be flying to join Tamer in Chicago tonight. It's opening on the West Coast as well.
And there is a way that, called TAG, people can really order screening all over the country. So it's a, if you go to junction48.film, you can see the whole system, how it works. I just want to say on the second part, this film really fight for women rights, very strong inside the community. And that's why I was so beautiful to hear Linda Sarsour saying, feminism who doesn't accept me with the hijab is not feminism, because the fight of Tamer and me, except of do great art, is to understand that fighting for women rights and fighting against Israeli oppression, it's the same fight.
We want to thank you both for being with us. Udi Aloni, Israeli-American director of Junction 48, Tamer Naffar, the film's lead actor and musical director, rap artist with the Palestinian hip-hop group Dom. When we come back, thousands of leaked documents published by WikiLeaks describe CIA programs to hack into both Apple and Android cell phones, smart TVs, even cars. We'll speak with the head of Electronic Frontier Foundation. Stay with us. By Blondie. And a shout out to the John Jay College of Criminal Justice, which is joining us today watching the broadcast. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.
We end today's show by looking at the publication of what WikiLeaks says is the largest leak of secret CIA documents in history. On Tuesday, WikiLeaks published the thousands of documents dubbed Vault 7. They describe CIA programs to hack into both Apple and Android cell phones, smart TVs, and even cars and trucks. This is WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange speaking at an online press conference on Thursday from the Ecuadorian embassy in London.
The Central Intelligence Agency lost control of its entire cyber weapons arsenal. Now, this is a historic act of devastating incompetence to have created such an arsenal and stored it all in one place and not secured it.
Some of the released documents describe tools to take over entire phones, allowing the CIA to then bypass encrypted messenger programs such as Signal, Telegram, and WhatsApp. Other documents outline a CIA and British intelligence program called Weeping Angel, through which the spy agency can hack into a Samsung smart television and turn it into a surveillance device that records audio conversations, even when it appears to be off. The leak also shows the CIA has reportedly looked for ways to hack into cars and trucks, which WikiLeaks said would quote, permit the CIA to engage in nearly undetectable assassinations.
Other documents outline how the CIA has used the U.S. consulate in Frankfurt, Germany, as a covert base to spy on Europe, the Middle East and Africa. The Vault 7 release totals close to 8,000 web pages and 943 attachments, which WikiLeaks says come from the CIA Center for Cyber Intelligence in Langley, Virginia. While the material was redacted by WikiLeaks to avoid releasing the actual computer code used in the programs, on Thursday, WikiLeaks founder Julian Assange said the organization would be sharing some of the code exclusively with tech companies so they can fix the vulnerabilities in their software. On the campaign trail, now President Donald Trump once said he loved WikiLeaks.
This just came out. This just came out. WikiLeaks. I love WikiLeaks.
Press Secretary Sean Spicer condemned the leaks, saying they threaten national security. Well, for more, we're going to San Francisco, where we're joined by Cindy Cohn, executive director of the Electronic Frontier Foundation. We don't have much time, Cindy, but if you can respond to this massive release, maybe the largest release of CIA documents in U.S. history.
Yeah, it certainly seems like it's a lot of information, and it's extremely troubling that the CIA was keeping all of this information rather than giving it to the tech companies so that they could fix these problems and make us all safer.
Can you talk about their significance? What most shocked you? Can you talk about the iPhones, the Androids, even cars, taking over a car electronically and causing it to crash?
Yeah, I have to say that there isn't much in this trove that shows any new attacks. These are all things that people outside of the CIA had been talking about and even doing some demonstrations of for a long time. So the particular techniques in here, I'd say for people who follow what's going on in digital security, they're not particularly surprising. So there's nothing really all that new in here. And in fact, to the extent that there was something somewhat surprising, but good news for us, is that the encrypted apps like Signal and WhatsApp, the government doesn't appear to be able to crack those. Now, they can get a hold of your phone and take over your phone in a way that such that they can read the message at the same time you do or at the same time you type it in. So there's still work to be done on operating systems and the underlying hardware. But the encrypted apps that people are increasingly relying on to do political activity or human rights activities, the apps themselves, so far, it looks like the CIA couldn't break them, which is good news.
Well, Cindy, some reports have suggested that the documents don't actually contain information on the most highly sensitive CIA cyber espionage. None of them appear to be classified above the level of secret, which is a relatively low level of classification. Now, is that the case?
Well, it's certainly the case that they're only marked secret. I think the guess that maybe there's some stuff that was more secret that hasn't been released and that wasn't in this trove seems reasonable to me, but I don't think we really know. We just know what got released. We really don't have a good picture of what might still exist that hasn't been that didn't leak.
What can you tell us about what the documents reveal about the U.S. consulate in Frankfurt, Germany?
Well, again, this is something that was not that surprising. We know that the CIA has operations all over the world. This has some specific information about a facility in Frankfurt that looks to have been focused on—well, it's not clear what it was focused on. The information talks about spying on Iran, which is, again, where they spy on Iran, the little bit news that that it's this place in Frankfurt. The fact that CIA has listening, you know, spots scattered around the world in secret locations itself isn't news. But I think the Germans are rightly concerned. I don't think it should be comfortable for them that the CIA is engaging in spying, I suspect, not just in not just on Iran, but on Germany itself.
And Cindy, we just have 10 seconds, but Julian Assange now saying he'll share the code with tech companies so they can close their vulnerabilities.
That's good news. That's good news. And the CIA should have done it a long time ago. The idea that the CIA knew about this problem, that this information got out of their control last year and doesn't appear to have told the tech companies, is, I think, shameful. And people need to really turn to the CIA and ask them why. Why aren't they standing with tech companies and with the American people and people around the world to have secure products?
Cindy Cohen.
That's where their interest should be.
We want to thank you for being with us, Executive Director of the Electronic Frontier Foundation. That does it for the broadcast. Democracy Now! Produced by Mike Burke, Dina Guzder, Carla Wills, Laura Gottesdiener, Sam Alkoff, John Hamilton, Robbie Caron, Honey Massoud. I'm Amy Goodman with Nermeen Sheikh.